तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।
Mechanical measurements. Towards the end of the lecture number 39, we were actually looking at the measurement of viscosity, and we described an apparatus to do that, the rotating cylinder viscometer. So, what I will be doing in the present lecture is to consider one example, which is example number 48, which is based on the rotating cylinder viscometer. After that, I am going to change the topic, and I will be describing in the rest of the period of this lecture and probably a little in the subsequent lecture also about radiation properties of surfaces and how they are measured. We are going to give some introductory ideas, then we will describe what are the quantities of interest, and then we will describe some methods of measurement of these. So, to just recapitulate, I am showing you the apparatus which was described in the previous lecture, the rotating concentric cylinder apparatus, which consists of a rotor, a stator which is held stationary, and there is a rotor which is surrounding it, and there is a gap in between the rotor and the stator, and the gap is filled with the fluid whose viscosity we want to determine. And there is a narrow gap which is given by the difference between the radius r2 and radius r1, and I call this gap B. At the bottom again there is a gap A, which is again filled with the same liquid whose viscosity we would like to know, and the length of this is given by L. I think the length symbol is missing here, but this is the length L which was introduced in the last lecture. It is the outer cylinder is rotated at a constant rotational speed of omega. Omega can be given in RPM, or it could be given in radians per second. Of course, it can be converted, one if one is given, the other can be obtained easily. So, the problem which I am going to look at is the following. So, the apparatus which was shown in the previous slide, it is run at an angular speed of 1800 plus or minus 5 RPM. So, this plus or minus 5 RPM apparently is the error in the measurement, or maybe there is a fluctuation in the RPM with respect to time. The geometric data is specified as under. The radius of the stator is 37 plus or minus 0.02 millimeter, and the radius of the inner radius of the rotor is 38 plus or minus 0.2 millimeters. The length of the apparatus is 100 plus or minus 0.5 millimeters, and the gap A is 3 plus or minus 0.01 millimeter. So, what is the torque experienced by the stationary cylinder is what we would like to find out, and also we would like to find out what is the power dissipated, given that the fluid in the viscometer is a linseed oil whose viscosity is known to be 0.0331 kilogram per meter second. I have also mentioned here that we would like to perform an error analysis. The error analysis is to bring out the effect of these plus or minus 5 RPM, plus or minus 0.02 mm, plus or minus 0.01 mm, and the plus or minus 0.5 mm. These are the errors in the various measured quantities, and we would like to find out how the torque experienced by the station cylinder as well as the power are affected because of these measurement errors. On the board, I am going to just work out the problem, but I am going to avoid the performance of the error analysis, and I am leaving it as an exercise for the student to pursue. So, I will just obtain the answers required in this problem, and the rest will be left to the student. So, let us go to the board and example 48. So, I will write down what are the different quantities which are given. The fluid is given or the liquid is given is linseed oil. I have taken linseed oil because the highly viscous fluid or viscous liquid, and the viscosity mu is given by 0.0331. The units is kg per meter second, or it is also Pascal times second, that is the unit, Pascal times second. So, the other important things which are required are the angular velocity omega is given by each rotation RPM means one revolution per minute. One revolution is 2 pi radians. So, I am going to multiply by 2 pi. I am going to multiply by RPM, which is 1800 RPM, which is given in the problem. And I am going to convert the value to radians per second. Therefore, I am going to divide by 60, which is 60 seconds in 1 minute. And therefore, this will give you in radians per second. This happens to be 188.5 radians per second. So, the other quantities of interest are the gap A, which is already given, is 3 millimeters. So, I will put it as 0.003 meter in SI units. And the gap B is nothing but R 2 minus R 1. And the R2 is 38 millimeters and R1 is 37 millimeters. So, this will be 1 millimeter. So, it becomes 0.001 meter. So, this is 0.038 minus 0.037 equal to that quantity. And the length of the apparatus is given as 100 millimeters or 0.1 meter. Actually, the exercise is very simple now. So, the torque T, I have already given the expression in the previous lecture. I am just going to write down that expression. It is given by mu pi omega R 1 squared multiplied by R 1 squared by 2 A plus 2 R 2 L by B. So, it is very straightforward. Mu is 0.0331, pi is your 3.14159142, omega already found out 188.5, R 1 squared is 0.037 whole squared. This multiplied by, so I will put the multiplication symbol here. R 1 squared is 0.037 squared divided by 2 into A is 0.003 plus 2 into 0.038 into length is 0.1 divided by B is 0.001, and the answer will be in Newton meter, product of force and distance, and this works out to 0.086 Newton meter. So, the torque which is experienced by the motor which is trying to rotate the outer cylinder is given by 0.086 Newton meter, or if you want to calculate in terms of Newton centimeters, it will be 8.6 Newton centimeters. The power can be easily obtained. The power consumed or power required is nothing but the product of torque times the angular velocity omega, and the torque is already calculated as 0.086 Newton meters multiplied by 188.5 radians per second. So, it will be Newton meter per second, which will be nothing but watts, and this comes to 16.2 watts. So, in the case of a viscometer having linseed oil in the gap, it requires about 16.2 watts, or so much of power is dissipated because of the friction, because of the viscosity of the fluid, and I am rotating it at 1800 rpm. The part which I am not going to work out here is the error analysis, but I would like to give a certain hint so that the student will understand how to go about, and for that let us go back to the previous page. And if you see here, I have got torque as given by an expression here. This is the expression I am talking about. The torque concerns the measured quantities which are going to come in the picture are R1, because mu, of course, we have not given any error bar on that, and therefore mu we will assume that it is not prone to any error. So omega, so the quantities which are having some error specified, I will underline. This is one of them, omega. Then R1, so again R1 here, and if you remember, A is given directly, so that is also having an error. Then R2 also has some error, and L is also having error, and B itself is nothing but R2 minus R1. So both of these have some error specified, and therefore B is also a quantity having some error. So what I have to do, or what you are expected to do, is to use the propagation of error formula which we gave long ago in one of the earlier lectures, and obtain all the influence coefficients with respect to omega, with respect to R1, with respect to A, with respect to R2, with respect to L, and with respect to B, of course, is automatically covered by R2 and R1, and then use the error propagation formula and work out what will be the error in the estimated value of T. And the next level, when you want to calculate the error in the value of the estimated value of the wattage or the power, again we know the, we use the power formula P equal to T omega. Again you can see that we have to use again the same error propagation formula for a product of these two. In the previous step we would have determined the error in T, and the error in omega is already given, so I can calculate the error in the power dissipated. So that is what the student is expected to do as a part of this particular problem. And now I will go back to the next topic which I am going to discuss, radiation properties of surfaces. So I want to give some really introductory ideas. The introductory ideas are going to be both for per se the radiation, and then secondly for surface properties, and further we are going to look at the application of radiation measurement to measurement of concentrations of gases. So in this lecture I am going to look at only the surface properties related things, and then as we proceed we will come back and look at the measurement of concentration using absorption of radiation by gases, for example. So for most part I am going to look at only opaque surfaces, because these are relevant from thermal engineering applications, and of course sometimes we also use either translucent or semi transparent materials like glass and so on, but we are not going to look at them because they are not, there is not much more involved than what we are going to discuss here, but these are more relevant because most of the time our applications will involve opaque surfaces, especially in mechanical engineering involving thermal engineering applications. It is the opaque surfaces which are more in use. We will also look at the, or pay attention to spectral and angular variation of surface properties. These are very important. When we talk about surface properties, we are talking about radiation being incident on some surface, and then subsequently what happens to that. And let me go back to the board and look at some of these issues. So what are the important things we look for in surface properties relating to radiation? So, radiation, when I talk about radiation, so let us give a brief background on radiation. So, we are actually talking about spanning a certain wavelength range. So, the radiation which we are going to talk about may span from ultraviolet, we are going from low wavelength and towards higher wavelength. Then we have visible and then we have the infrared. So, we can generally divide the wavelength range into three categories, the ultraviolet range, then the visible part of the spectrum and the infrared part of the spectrum. And the ultraviolet is of course useful in some applications, and especially if you are looking at the degradation of materials because of exposure to radiation, solar radiation for example, there is a lot of ultraviolet radiation coming from the sun. So, such studies do require ultraviolet radiation, and they require the study of behavior of surfaces when ultraviolet radiation is impinging on them. The second part, the visible part, is also very useful because in mostly in solar energy applications. In solar energy applications, we come across surfaces which either absorb or reflect solar radiation, and depending on the application, we may want absorption to actually take place or we may want the reflection to take place so that the radiation is not allowed to penetrate into the space in which we are interested. For example, if you have a building, you would like the solar energy not to get into the building. If the idea is to keep the inside cool, especially in the tropics during the summer, you would like to keep the inside of the building cool, and therefore, you would like to avoid the penetration of the heat or the solar heat into the building. However, if you are considering the application of application to a solar collection device, you would like the solar energy to be actually absorbed as much as possible, so that it is used, it is useful, it is available as useful heat energy for further processing. So, in the visible part of spectrum, we are very subtly interested, and the properties of surfaces are very important and they play a significant role in engineering applications. Also, in space applications like satellite thermal control and so on, the properties of surfaces which are exposed to solar energy play a very important role. Therefore, from that point of view, we would like to look at the surface properties which are subject to radiation from the sun falling on them. Then of course, the infrared part is an important aspect, because most of the terrestrial applications, so terrestrial applications, we have temperatures close to the 300 Kelvin, which is the room temperature. In these terrestrial applications, the radiation which is involved is mostly infrared part of the spectrum. Infrared cannot be seen, it only can be felt, and it is important to consider infrared properties of surfaces, because most surfaces we use in engineering applications either absorb or reflect or emit radiation on their own because of their own temperature. So, these are the things. In other words, if we look at the processes which are going to take place, let us just look at that. So, suppose you have a surface. So, if I put a surface here, right now I am only talking about surfaces, we will later talk about the gases and so on, which is not important right now. So, if you have a surface, I am just idealizing the surface by straight line, which shows the, so the inside the surface there is a medium, different medium. In other words, the surface actually separates two regions. One, for example, I can consider vacuum here, or I can just consider air or atmosphere. Or many, for many purposes, air is transparent, and therefore, right now we can just consider the either vacuum or air, it does not matter which it is. And we have an engineering surface, and this surface is going to separate two regions, one vacuum or air, and inside there is a solid. So, we will say this is a solid material. So, let us look at what is going to happen at this surface. If the surface is optically smooth, so if I assume it is optically smooth, this is one possibility. Of course, in engineering applications mostly, we are not going to meet with optically smooth surfaces, but suppose we have an optically smooth surface. If you draw the normal to this surface, this is the normal. If the light is incident or the radiation is incident at an angle of incidence equal to I, it is reflected specularly. These are the two angles, this is R, this is reflected. So, I will say this is incident, this is reflected light, and the angle I equal to R. So, I put I as angle I equal to R. Okay. So, you have a specular reflection. So, how do we characterize this reflection? If some amount of energy is incident or some amount of power is incident on the surface, the fraction of the power which is reflected is the reflectivity. So, we can say reflected fraction, we will call it as reflectivity. So, if we are able to measure both the amount of incident radiation as well as if we are able to measure the reflected radiation by taking the ratio of one with respect to the other, we will get the reflectivity surface. And this generally is a function of the angle I. It is a function of the angle I. That means, if I have a specular surface, the reflectivity of the surface depends on the angle. That is, for a smooth, optically smooth surface, the reflection is specular. It follows the Snell's laws of reflection, and that means that the angle of incidence equal to angle of reflection, which is what we learn in high school physics. And but the important thing to note is that the reflectivity is not a constant, but it depends on the angle. So, if we want to measure the reflectivity of this surface, we must have an arrangement by which radiation is going to be incident at a desired angle with respect to the normal, and I must make a measurement at the correct angle at the along the specular direction and look at how much energy is going to be reflected along that direction, take the ratio and get it, and I have to do it for different angles. Therefore, I must have a method. An apparatus must consist of a method by which I can have the energy coming at different angles in a nice small narrow beam, and the reflected amount must be gathered and then by detected or measured by detector, photo detector, and then we take the ratio of these two to get the reflectivity, and this has to be done with at different angles. So, I must have a method or an apparatus must be able to change the angle as we require. So, that is what is involved in the case of a specular reflector. Suppose I look at so called engineering surfaces. So, normally what happens in the case of engineering surfaces is that they are rough. There is no smoothness, there is no optical smoothness. Actually, how do we characterize the roughness or the smoothness? We have to compare the when you have a rough surface, let me just draw a rough surface. Rough surface will show some kind of undulations. It is going to show, it is a, even though it is a surface is straight, it is a planar surface, this is the mean line, but the surface itself shows undulations. These undulations, if you call that, let us say, I will call it epsilon. If epsilon is much smaller than the wavelength lambda, we call it a smooth surface. If epsilon is very large compared to lambda, it becomes a rough surface. And as we mentioned earlier, we may be talking about lambda varying from the ultraviolet part, then the visible part, and then the infrared. The lambda is not a constant, it depends on the particular application. So, if you want to consider some surface as smooth in the visible part of the spectrum, visible radiation, then the surface, if this quantity epsilon must be much smaller than that the wavelength of the corresponding radiation. For example, if you take a visible part, something like 0.5 micrometers, that means the epsilon should be much smaller compared to 0.5 micrometers to consider the surface as smooth in the visible part of the spectrum. Suppose I go to the infrared part and I look at 15 micrometers, surface which is rough for visible radiation may appear smooth for infrared radiation. So, because the wavelength is much larger, so the surface roughness element epsilon could be much larger and still it may appear as a smooth surface. So, smoothness and roughness is a relative term, and the term is to be used with reference to the wavelength of the radiation which we are going to be talking about. So, suppose I consider engineering surface as a rough surface, what it means is that the undulations are very severe and such that they are much larger than or equal much larger than the wavelength which I am interested in. Therefore, the surface is not a smooth surface, it appears as having ridges and valleys and so on. So, it will appear like this. So, suppose I take a small part of that, very small part of that, and let us say I assume I draw a normal. The normal to the mean line is this line, this is the mean normal. So, the mean normal is given like this. Suppose I draw a normal to the small infinitesimal area which I have chosen at a particular place, the normal is oriented like this. This is the local normal. This is the local normal. So, the mean normal and the local normal are not the same, and this local normal will keep varying, the direction of the local normal will keep varying. And therefore, if we have, for example, let me make a separate sketch and show what may be happening. So, suppose I exaggerate somewhat, suppose this is the surface, and suppose I draw the normal here, it is like this, here the normal is like this, and here the normal is like this. Suppose I have a parallel radiation falling on it in this direction, radiation is falling along direction, this will be reflected like this. This angle will be equal to this angle and it will be reflected in this direction, whereas here it will be reflected like this and here it will be reflected like this. These angles are same. Therefore, even though parallel radiation is falling on it, I have exaggerated of course, this is going in this direction, this is going in this direction, this is going in this direction. Therefore, you see that it is the reflected radiation is going in all sorts of directions. So, reflection, reflected direction is along different directions. In principle, if we define a surface being totally rough engineering wise, then what it means is that the radiation which is reflected will be going in all directions, and therefore, we call such surface as a diffuse reflector. diffuse reflector. So, we have two extremes. We have an optically plane surface or optically plane smooth surface, and we have an optically rough so called plane surface, but of course, the mean line is here. Even here I can draw a mean line. This is the surface, mean surface, but the actual surface is undulating. Of course, it is a three dimensional surface, I am just drawing a cross section. It means it is going to happen in all directions. Whichever cross section you take of the surface, there will be undulation. And therefore, if a beam of light is falling at a particular angle, it will be redistributed into all the different angles possible, and we say such a reflector is a diffuse reflector. So, completely the surface, the reflected radiation does not show any dependence on the direction in which it has come on the surface. So, that directionality is completely forgotten. Of course, the amount which is reflected may be dependent on the incoming direction, but as far as the directionality is concerned, there is no directionality. In other words, it is reflected equally well in all the directions, therefore, we call it a diffuse reflector. So, a perfect diffuse reflector is one which will reflect in all directions in a diffuse fashion. So, these are the two extreme cases, and obviously, we can think in terms of some kind of a intermediary behavior for various surfaces. Suppose, I have a surface which is optically smooth in one region, optically rough or totally rough in another region. There may be some wavelength region where it will be neither totally optically smooth nor totally optically rough, and therefore, it will show probably an intermediate behavior. So, let us just see what will happen. So, if I draw that surface, I have got radiation coming in this direction. This is the normal to the surface. So, I will call it as the normal. So, this is the angle theta at which it is falling on it. Now, what will happen if I draw a line corresponding to the specular direction? This is also equal to theta. So, there will be more reflection along this direction and less along the other direction. Therefore, you may get reflection like this. So, reflection may show some specular, this we call as a specular component. At the same time, it also shows reflection in other along the other direction. So, in this case, this is the most general case, we will call it as general case. It is neither optically smooth nor rough. So, it is some kind of an intermediate case. So, the incoming radiation when it is reflected will show two types of behavior. One, a component along the specular direction which is more than what normally would be found along the other direction, and the presence of reflection along the other direction. Therefore, in this case, for a single incoming direction, reflected radiation goes along all the directions, but with different strengths or different reflectivities. Therefore, this is the most general and most difficult to characterize or measure. Okay? So, we have some knowledge of the or some idea about the surface properties, and let us look at a few more quantities. Suppose, we have an opaque surface. Suppose, I have an opaque surface. What does it mean? It means that the reflectivity, I will call it as rho, plus what is absorbed, I will call it as alpha. So, these are fractions. Rho is the amount which is reflected from what is incident along the on the surface, and alpha is absorbed. Therefore, this must be equal to 1, because the two fractions must add up to. So, this is nothing but conservation of energy, conservation of radiation energy or radiant energy. So, what is incident on the surface should either be reflected or should be absorbed, because it is a opaque surface. Nothing is penetrating into the surface. Therefore, it is either reflected or absorbed at the surface. So, rho plus alpha equal to 1. Now, what it means is that I need not measure both rho and alpha separately. If you measure one, the other one can be estimated, because it is nothing but 1 minus alpha. Okay? Of course, this statement is somewhat not very accurate, somewhat loose, because there is a directionality and there is also dependence on wavelength. Therefore, if you want, you can say here rho lambda, that is alpha lambda equal to 1 for a given wavelength, and that is slightly better than what I said earlier. But of course, for the sake of this course, which is most basically an understanding of measurement, I think it is little bit of imprecision is probably all right, even though it may be somewhat jarring to the specialist in the field, because we do not have enough time to look at all the details. We are just trying to find out what is required for our immediate purpose, that is to make some simple measurements of surface properties. So, we have now some idea about what we are talking about. So, at a surface, either reflection or absorption can take place, and there is a third one which I would like to look at now. This is the third property, which this is because of the temperature of the surface itself, you will have emission. So, any surface at a temperature above 0 Kelvin will radiate, and emission is characterized by a property called emissivity. So, what I am going to do is to look at how to define this quantity called emissivity. So, emissivity means it has something to do with the amount of radiation emitted from the surface. Okay. Now, how do I characterize that? So, the one way of doing it is to compare the actual surface to a black surface or a black body. So, we know from physics that a black body or black surface at a temperature T, I am now looking at only the total radiation coming from the surface. We will look at the monochromatic or the spectral values later. Suppose we have a black surface at temperature T, it emits Eb equal to sigma T to the power of 4. The total amount of radiation leaving the black surface per unit area is simply given by sigma T to the power 4, where sigma is the Stefan-Boltzmann constant and T is the absolute temperature of the surface. So, emissivity can be defined, this is the total, or it is also called integrated, that means integrated over lambda from 0 to infinity, from the lowest possible to the highest possible wavelength. Of course, in practice, the 0 to infinity may mean something like from 0.1 to 100 micrometers. If you consider that region, it is adequate. In some cases, it may be even narrower than that, depending on the temperature. So, I am having a black surface which emits radiation per unit area. This is in watts per square meter, given by sigma T to the power 4. The sigma is the Stefan-Boltzmann constant, and in fact, the value of sigma is 5.67 multiplied by 10 to the power of minus 8 watts per meter squared Kelvin raised to the power of 4. 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8 watts per meter squared Kelvin to the power of 4. Now, suppose the amount emitted by the actual surface, we will say EA. This is again so many watts per meter squared of the actual surface at the temperature T. If I divide it by Eb at the same temperature T, this we call as the emissivity epsilon, is the emissivity. So, in this case, I am looking at the emissivity, total emissivity. That means, total means from all, including all wavelengths which are possible. Of course, now this definition can be particularized to a particular wavelength also. So, what I have to do is I have to find out how much energy or power is radiated from the actual surface in a small wavelength region, and compare it with that from a black body, and the amount which is radiated from by the black body in a certain small wavelength is given by the Planck distribution function. So, this ratio will be the actual surface will give some value of emission in that narrow band of wavelength at lambda, that divided by the corresponding Planck radiation function will give the emissivity at that particular value, that is at lambda. So, you can also define what is called epsilon lambda, which is also called the monochromatic emissivity. So, I think this amount of background is adequate for appreciating what we are going to talk about, and therefore, we just say that it is possible to define a monochromatic emissivity, and correspondingly we can also define a monochromatic absorptivity and the monochromatic reflectivity. Okay. And there is a law called Kirchhoff's law, which says that the monochromatic emissivity and the absorptivity are exactly the same. So, epsilon lambda equal to alpha lambda. So, this is your Kirchhoff's law. Say that epsilon lambda equal to alpha lambda. So, let us leave it at that. Now, let us look at what are the things which we require if we want to make a measurement of surface properties. What are the things required? So, requirement in terms of the hardware, we are talking about hardware. So, what we require for making measurement of radiation is we require first of all source of radiation. Source of radiation. I think we have already looked at this source of radiation to a small extent when we are talking about pyrometry. We talked about a black body source. So, we can have a cavity radiator which will give black body radiation, and that could be a source of radiation. Of course, that is normally not used in practice. We may use some other source of light, like for example, we have the tungsten filament lamp, or we can use a glowing resistor which is heated by electrical means and it glows and gives radiation and so on. So, it is called a glow bar. So, various different sources are used. For example, if you want source in the UV region, you require a special source for that. You require special lamps which will give ultraviolet radiation. In the visible part of spectrum, we are familiar with the various kind of things. For example, you have the tungsten filament lamp which gives you nice visible part of spectrum. Similarly, in the infrared part of spectrum, we can use a hot object itself as a source of radiation. We can also use lasers, for example. Lasers can be in different part of the spectrum, and we can use lasers also as a source of radiation. So, number one, we require source of radiation. Number two, of course, this will be, there can be two types of sources. One we call as broadband. That means spanning a large wavelength range. For example, a black body is a broadband source, or you may want a monochromatic source. So, there are two ways of going about. You can use a broadband source and use a monochromator and get that. From a broadband, use a monochromator. For example, a spectrometer. A spectrometer which uses, for example, a prism, which is very familiar to all of us. It can be a grating. Or in modern times, we also use interferometers. These are used as monochromators, or you can have a monochromatic source itself. For example, if you take a bulb filled with sodium and the sodium vapor is going to give rise to radiation, it has got a specific wavelength at which is going to radiate, and therefore, it is already monochromatic radiation. Or you take the case of lasers, they are monochromatic sources of radiation. They have specific wavelengths or specific frequency at which it will give you the light. Therefore, either you can have a broadband source and from which you using a monochromator spectrometer, you make a monochromatic source, or use directly a monochromatic source of radiation. This is the first requirement. The second requirement is some optical arrangement. So, optical arrangement which may involving, for example, slits, then it may involve lenses, mirrors, etcetera. This is normally we call it steering. The radiation which is coming from the source needs to be taken to some particular space where you want to conduct the experiment, where you want to study the, for example, you must make it incident on a surface. So, you must steer it by using lenses, slits, mirrors, etcetera. We do that. So, some optical arrangement is required, and therefore, radiation measurement always involves some optical arrangement. And in fact, this is the reason why radiation measurements are very expensive. Monochromatry is very expensive, and then the optical arrangement involving lenses, mirrors, etcetera are very expensive. And therefore, the measurements we are talking about are all mostly very expensive measurements we are talking about in terms of the amount of money required to set up the experimental setup. Then we require, the most importantly, detectors. Detectors can be broadly classified into two categories. One, like what we had earlier, like the broadband and monochromatic. Here also we have what are called thermal detectors. We have already come across this earlier. We talked about a set of thermocouple junctions being used in the form of a large number of hot and cold junctions, and we have already looked at it earlier. We talked about this issue when we were talking about heat flux measurement. So, thermal measurement means you are going to convert the effect of the radiation will be to heat something, and that temperature is going to be measured, and from this I am going to find out what is the amount of radiation which is falling on it. And the second measurement, second type, is called the quantum detectors, which rely on either photovoltaic or photoconducting or photomultiplier effects. So, these are all quantum detectors, actually detect the photons through any of these three I described. Photoresistive, that means that resistance of an element will change when photons are impinging on that one, or photovoltaic, that means the voltage will be generated when photons are going to fall on the detector, or it may be photomultiplier, what happens in the photomultiplier is the electrons are rejected and these are accelerated using electrical fields to get, and they actually impinge on secondary electrodes and they multiply the number of electrons, and therefore it is called photomultiplier. So, we can say here usually photovoltaic, and photo conducting, that means the resistance of some element is going to change in the presence of radiation field, or it may be photo multipliers. These are also called PMTs. These photo multipliers come with different materials, so that they will respond in different regions of the electromagnetic spectrum, and they are the most sensitive. The photomultipliers are the most sensitive in all these things which we have talked about. And many times what we do is, we cool the detector to very low temperature, so that the noise can be reduced, and usually it is done by cooling the detector to liquid nitrogen temperature. So, you see that the detector is itself is a photonic photo detector, quantum detector. It needs a cooling arrangement, liquid nitrogen is required, it is expensive. So, you see that all we are talking about very expensive equipment now. So, these are the parts which are required. Apart from this, we also require some accessories. Accessories like in the case of reflection measurement, I have to have an arrangement by which radiation can be coming at a certain angle, and I must be able to measure the reflected part at another angle. So, there must be some measure, some method for measuring these angles accurately, and we have what is called a goniometer. Goniometer is an arrangement by which we can illuminate and study the reflection at a specified angles, measure these angles accurately, and that is done by goniometer. Of course, the goniometer related measurements are the most accurate, and they are usually used as the basis for other methods or calibrating other devices. Or we can also use one simple gadget which is called the integrating sphere. So, these accessories by themselves are not useful, they have to be used along with the rest of the things I talked about. You need a source, a manochromator, then you must have some kind of a steering arrangement for making the light take a particular direction, and then you must have a detector, and the goniometer, the integrating sphere comes in between these things. So, the source of light and the other extreme is the detector of light or measurement of light. In between these two, we have a certain number of different things which are coming. And one of them could be a goniometer, one of them could be integrating sphere, it could be a monochromator, and so on and so forth. And many times what we do is, because we have to measure two quantities, if you remember the reflectivity, you need to measure the incoming radiation as well as the reflected radiation. So, you must measure two things. So, you require either two detectors, or the same detector must receive both alternatively, so that you can measure one or the other and then find out what is the ratio. So, you see that it is a very challenging task. Therefore, these methods of measurement require apparatus which are made very carefully in specialized laboratories and workshops, and they are supplied at great cost, and therefore, radiation involves very expensive equipment. Now, let us just briefly touch upon this integrating sphere before we go back and make and discuss more fully these things. So, I will go back to the simply to tell something about the integrating sphere. We will not completely be able to do that. In the next lecture, we will continue with that. So, what does an integrating sphere do, or what does it contain? Actually, by the name integrating sphere, it is a spherical shaped chamber. So, I have just shown it as a circle here, and it has got an opening for light to enter. And what happens when the light enters the integrating sphere? The inside of the integrating sphere is given a coating which has got two important properties. One, it is very highly reflecting, let us say 95% or 97% or 99% reflectivity. Number one. Number two, it is a perfectly diffuse reflector. That means, if radiation falls on this surface, it is distributed immediately to all the directions possible. So, an integrating sphere is essentially a spherical chamber, and you have an arrangement by which you can allow light to enter it through a small port or entrance port as shown here, and then when it falls on the inside surface, it gets reflected in all directions. So, basically this is the principle of the integrating sphere. Now, what can happen inside? So, what will happen is that when it falls on this surface, it is reflected in all directions, and the reflected light may either fall, it may fall on any other part of the sphere after reflection, because it is going in all directions. So, suppose I follow this, one ray came here and it got reflected here, it undergoes another reflection, or it goes here, it goes through another reflection. So, a large number of reflections are going to take place inside, and if you look at any part of the sphere, any part of the sphere, the radiation which entered at one particular spot gets completely redistributed throughout the sphere, and there will be uniform, near uniform illumination inside of this radiation. Okay? So, what I am talking about is a device which is able to give me, by the design of that particular device, because you have a certain coating, certain high reflectivity as well as highly diffuse coating, it is able to give you uniform illumination inside. And therefore, you can immediately see that if I put a reflecting sample at any one part of the sphere, a small hole I make and I introduce my sample, the radiation which is falling on it will be perfectly diffuse radiation falling on it. Okay? So, now suppose I look at the radiation reflected from this sample by making another hole here and allowing the some radiation to escape. So, I will be able to measure the hemispherical direction. That means that the surface is illuminated throughout the hemisphere. We will describe more fully in the next lecture. We will come back to this issue. It is illuminated from all directions, and then in one particular direction I am finding out how much is the amount of reflection. And by measuring the amount which is incident and amount which is reflected, I will be able to characterize what is called the hemispherical direction reflectivity. We will define this quantity little more carefully in the next lecture. So, in the next lecture, I will also talk about another arrangement. In this case, I allowed the radiation to impinge on the reflecting surface from all directions and I measure the reflected light. I can also do the exactly the opposite. I can allow light to be impinging on this sample, and after reflection, it gets reflected in all directions from the reflecting sample. This is going to be gathered by the sphere, and the sphere is going to respond to the entirely to the amount of energy which is reflected from the surface in all directions. And therefore, if I make a hole here and I allow the reflected light to pass through, I will be sensing or I will be measuring a quantity which is related to the hemispherical value corresponding to the reflecting sample. So, it is coming at a given angle with respect to the normal, and the reflection in all directions is covered by the integrating sphere. In fact, this is the reason why it is called the integrating sphere. It integrates over the hemisphere on the surface. So, it measures all the radiation which is coming in all the directions of the hemisphere from a particular surface of the sample which is kept in a part of the spherical enclosure. So, I think we will stop here, and in the next class, next lecture, we will try to continue from here. Thank you very much.